Sunlight streams through dozens of windows as I look around at rows of large blue tanks. The sound of running water and the smell of fish permeates the small building. I look down into the closest tank and thousands of tiny fish come into view through the dark water. We then walk to another nearby building and go inside. It's a large warehouse with four small concrete canals filled with water. As I walk closer to one of the indoor rivers, I'm greeted by dozens of large jumping rainbow trout that bring the water to a boil with their swarming. If you saw these two unassuming buildings from the outside, you would never guess that inside, thousands of fish are hatched and raised every year to be stocked around the state. This is Wild, a Utah Division of Wildlife Resources podcast. I'm your host, Faith Heaton Jolly, and this is episode 6, Inside a Fish Hatchery. All right, so welcome back to Wild. This is our 6th episode now, which seems kind of crazy that it's been going this long. But we hope that you guys have kind of enjoyed the journey, learning more about the Utah Division of Wildlife Resources and some of the work that we do. So today I was able to come down to Springville and take a tour of the fish hatchery here. And joining me, I'm going to have Brennan Hannifin. He's the assistant supervisor for the Springville hatchery. He's going to basically explain what all goes into managing a fish hatchery, how they work, what they do, and then kind of some of the fish stocking process that we have. So first of all, thanks for letting me drag you around everywhere today.
Yeah, it was good. We got to go show you around and show you how the process works. It was really good.
And honestly, so just having gone through this, I told Brennan, I have been in one other fish hatchery. It was the one down in Hatch.
Mm-hmm. Mammoth Creek.
Yep. When I was in like 4th grade and I was on a school field trip and I remember next to nothing about it. So
yeah, that's what a lot of people tell us. They're like, we came here like when 20 years ago or 30 years ago and checked it out, but that was all we knew about it.
Yep. Yep. And so this was really eye-opening and honestly fascinating. And I did not realize how much goes into fish hatchery.
Yeah,
it's involved.
Yeah, it's crazy. Like most people just think it's, you know, a pond with water and you're putting fish food on them and that's it.
But right.
I mean, there's oxygen issues and all sorts of stuff, treating the water. I mean, there's a lot that goes into it.
There's a lot. So yeah, so kind of walk us through that. So what's the initial process? And this was something that I thought was interesting. Start with kind of where do we get all the water for these hatcheries?
So all the hatcheries in Utah are basically sitting on springs that have their own springs. And so we have about 8 to 10 different springs that are bubbling up, and then they all combine into one little pond up above our hatchery. Then we collect that water, we pipe it down into our hatchery, and we treat it. We go through our big degasser to take out CO2 and add oxygen. And we go through our drum filters and our UV lights to clean the water up.
And explain what those, because I was kind of looking at them, what do those lights do to the water?
It's just UV light, and I have no clue how UV light kills what it, you know, but it kills the bacteria that's in the water. So when they built that, they calculated out if the water's flow, if you have this many gallons of water flowing at this rate, you'll need this much UV light to cleanse the water. So that was all something the engineers figured out.
But it's basically just a safe way to purify the water before it gets to your fish.
Well, with the big drum filters, you're getting out all the dirt and debris and leaves or anything that could come from the pond. And so you're pretty, the water is basically cleaned out of any debris by the time it gets to the lights. But when you get to the UV lights, then it's really trying to zap anything else.
Okay. So, and it's just kind of its own separate building up there. It's kind of cool. It's this whole purification station.
Yeah, so above there, it goes clear through that whole purification building before it gets anywhere near the fish.
Right.
So we got to make sure it's completely clean water before it gets the fish or we'll get sick fish.
So, and then once it's purified, then explain kind of the next step, the next building with
so,
the little guys.
When we get our eggs, So we get them from two different places. You'd either be a wild source usually, where they're just spawning wild fish. They're capturing them and spawning them, and that's where we're getting our eggs.
And for those who don't know what that means, I've witnessed this, and the best way I can describe it to people who aren't biologists, they're basically squeezing fish and they're getting eggs and sperm out of them and mixing it into a little fish baby smoothie.
Yeah. So basically you're going in and you're getting your females in your males, and it's not, most of the time, it's not a very hard process. If a female's ready to give eggs or do anything like that, then,
they're popping out.
Yeah. You're just barely rubbing along their belly and they're popping out. And you're, so it's and same
gross.
With the males.
I'm
yeah.
not going to lie.
But you're just kind of collecting that all in a little basin.
Right.
And then they're just mixing that up, and we bring those eggs down and they're fertilized, and we just put them in a little flow of water. So like I showed you, we either have those trays that we keep them in with fresh water mm-hmm. or the jars. And then once they hatch out, we put them in our troughs.
Okay. And how long does it usually take from them to be fertilized until they start hatching?
For us, it's with the trout side. And we forgot to talk about that. When we do the trout, they actually have two hatcheries, the Egan Hatchery and the Manaway Hatchery, that have brood stock. And they're the bigger female and male trout that are 4 years old plus that we're getting our eggs from. But when we get them, they're in the thing for about 2 weeks, usually in the eyeing jars or in the trays for about 2 weeks.
Okay.
And then they'll start hatching. And they might be, it kind of depends on the species and stuff, but sometimes they're a week from, you know, a week or two from when the first ones start hatching. It doesn't happen really fast till the rest are done hatching.
And then once they've hatched, then you put them in those big tanks. Yeah.
Yep. So that's when they've hatched, we'll move them into those tanks. And during that time, they'll actually have their mouth won't be developed enough to eat. They'll actually have just a big belly on them. Like I always tell the kids, it's like a chicken and an egg with the yolk.
Oh, right.
So they have a big sack on their belly, and that's where they're getting all their nutrition from, because they're not eating at that time, but they're still growing.
When they're little tiny.
Yeah. So this time we're not feeding them. They're kind of just sitting on the bottom. They're not swimming around. They have a tail and everything, but they're not fully there yet. They have this big belly on them. So they're just getting all their nutrition through that sack. After that, when they start swimming up and kind of hitting the surface, that's when you know they're ready to start eating. So that's when they're fully developed enough, and we'll start sprinkling on a little bit of feed. And it's really fine, like powder, basically. Mm-hmm. And then they'll slowly over, it usually takes them a couple weeks to them all to figure it out. But after they figure it out, they know it's feeding time after that.
It was kind of fun walking by some of the bigger ones. Like you said, when they see people walking past, they think you're going to feed them. So they were jumping up and uh-huh. splashing, and it was kind of fun to see that. So, and when you have these fish in these tanks, uh-huh. when they're little tiny, how many typically do you have in at a time when they're growing?
So each tank, we'll probably put about 20,000 in each tank when we're hatching them out. But when we're just getting a group of fish, we can get hundreds of thousands of fish at one time. So say for us, we might get a group in the spring that's 200,000, and then usually a group in the fall that's 150,000.
Okay, so it's a ton of fish that we're raising
yeah.
in these hatcheries.
And so for our hatchery in a year, we probably raise about 300,000 fish, and we've had years where we've raised 500,000 fish out of this hatchery in a year.
That's a lot.
And it'll be about 120,000 pounds of fish usually.
Wow.
I don't know the exact numbers for the whole state, but I know pounds-wise, we probably raise over 1 million pounds a year yeah. out of the hatcheries that we have, the state hatcheries.
That's a lot. And so from when they're in these, when they're little tiny in these tanks, mm-hmm. how big do they get before you transfer them from those little tanks to kind of the bigger?
Yeah, so basically areas. They'll go from that half-inch little tiny fingerling to 3 inches long, and then when they get to 3 inches, that's when we'll transfer them from our tanks out to our, what we call our raceways. So they're big cement, basically. I don't know what you'd even, how you could picture them, but.
I know. They kind of look like just little rivers
yeah.
inside of a building.
Yeah.
And the bank is made out of cement. Yeah. And in this particular, in the Springville hatchery, there were 4 raceways that you used.
Yep. So we're using 4 raceways, and then we break it up into 3 different sections. So we call it the A section, the B section, and the C section from the top down. So that's what we use to separate the fish. So we'll have fish that are, we're aiming to get to 10 inches by next spring, but we also can't, so say we get our 100,000 eggs to start, right?
Right.
We only need to stock 10,000 of those fish in March, 10,000 of those fish the next month, but we can't have them all be 10 inches at one time.
Sure.
When we get them in there, we kind of start breaking them up. So we have one raceway that we're feeding a little bit more to push them to get to that 10-inch mark in March. And we have one raceway that we're not feeding as much as those guys because we want them to be 10 inches almost clear in August when you're and you're working with the same lot of fish.
Gotcha. So you're trying to stagger it.
Yeah,
so
you're just staggering it. So number one, you're not outgrowing your space because if we just sat and fed them, I mean, we'd get so much, the fish would get so big, we wouldn't even have space. So
right.
That's what we're always managing, space and time of when, you know, when the ice is going to come off or when we're going to be able to go put the fish in.
Gotcha. And kind of what is that time frame for from the beginning when you get the eggs to when you are stocking them?
Yeah. So for us, it's about 14 months, probably 12 to 14 months. So we can grow our fish if we feed them as much as we could to get them to grow the most we can, about an inch a month. But it depends completely on your water temperature. So some hatcheries, our hatchery has 58 degree water, which is perfect for trout.
So because it's more of a cold water species.
Yeah. So if you get warmer than that with trout, it might be good for others, but not as much for trout. So when we're talking about, you know, the rainbow that we're raising, 58's perfect. We're getting really good growth rates. But some hatcheries, their springs are in the 40s degrees, you know, low 40s. So it might take them almost 2 years to grow a fish from an egg to 10 inches where we can do it in a year pretty much.
So the growth rate really is dependent on how much you're feeding them and how warm your water is.
Typically. Yeah, so there's a couple of factors. The feed and the water temperature, but also space. If you don't have space too, like if they're crowded, even if you're feeding the same and whatever, they're still not going to get the growth. So yeah, when we really need to grow fish, we'll give them plenty of space and feed them and we can blow them up pretty quick.
Gotcha. That's really interesting. So they will kind of just fit the space that they're in.
Yeah. Yeah. It definitely affects them. It's if you have a few less fish in one raceway, just a little bit more feed and a little bit more space will make a big difference.
That's so crazy. Yeah. And it is. I mean, like you said, it's a total production, like mm-hmm. all the stuff that goes into it. So, and from when you, well, and kind of go into how much are you feeding the bigger fish in those raceways in that second building?
So in the raceways, once we move them into the raceways, it's kind of the same thing. Like one section, like 2A, so our second raceway, our top one, say that'll usually have about 20,000 fish, about the same as a tank would
right.
in the hatchery. And we'll be feeding that. We can feed them up to that one little section could get 60 pounds in a day.
Yeah, that's crazy.
And still it'd be fine. But most of the time it's about 40 to 60 pounds when we're trying to feed them to get them to size.
Okay. And so tell us, like, kind of once they reach that target size, which you said is usually 10 to 12 inches?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So once they reach that, what's the next step? Like, how do we take them from there to stocking them?
So we're the whole time we're kind of anticipating, okay, we're trying to grow our fish to reach 10 inches in March with this group. So every month we'll go through and we'll actually sample the fish and look at, okay, how long are our fish? How much do they weigh? We'll just get a little sample, like 20 fish at each raceway and kind of give us a good idea of how big the fish are. So before we stock them, we'll also sample them, make sure they're to size. And then it's basically whatever the biologist, if the biologist said we want this many in, we get them to that size. And then when that time comes, we haul them out. And if the water's ready, you know, if right. the water quality's good and it's not too hot or there's no ice or we can access it, then that's when we'll take them.
Gotcha. And what's kind of the process of transporting them from the hatchery here okay. to the pond?
So when we're hauling them, it's usually we're pulling the truck in. We'll actually have a guy, he gets in his waders and he'll usually crowd them up. He has a little screen and he'll kind of like crowd them up.
Fish so herding.
Yeah. It's literally fish herding.
I'm redneck, so I'm like herding. I understand that. Like with cows, yeah.
But we have to be able to, it's more to just get them with a net, you know? So, because if we try and get them, we'd be chasing them all up and down. So we kind of crowd them up a little bit, and then we'll net whatever we need, how many ever pounds and fish we're taking that day onto our trucks. But if we're
you're weighing them as you're scooping them out.
So I didn't show you this, but on the trucks we actually have a gauge.
Oh.
So we'll fill the tank on our truck halfway up with water, and then there's a gauge on the side, and it shows where the water level's at. So as we're scooping fish on, it's displacing that water. So like it's like when you get in the bathtub and the water level goes up, we're scooping fish onto the truck. And that water level's going up in the tank, which is putting it up on our gauge.
So you can tell approximately.
So we can tell relatively close, you know. Okay, we put on 300 pounds of fish, and they were 2 fish to the pound, so we put on 600 fish.
Oh, you guys are geniuses. Okay, I'm getting it. Okay. So, and so you kind of just net them into your truck, and then.
Yeah, so we'll net them until we'll set our gauges to whatever we want. We'll net them to where we get. Whatever, 600 fish or 1,000 fish, whatever we're hauling that day. Then we just make sure we have our oxygen on. We have aerators that kind of do the same thing as our degasser, kind of puts fresh air into the water. And then we will haul them to wherever we're going to haul them. And depending on how close we can get to the water, we'll either dump them in. We have a tube that we can put on the back and just send them right through that tube out into the water. If we can't get close enough, maybe we have to net them out of the truck and actually run them as fast as we can to get them to the lake.
You're doing like scoop by scoop.
Yeah,
like
scoop
manually.
By scoop, yeah.
Wow.
If we don't do a truck, if we don't can't access it with a truck, we'll do four-wheelers, horses. They do airplanes, a lot of airplane stocking up on the Uintas and the Boulders.
Those videos have gone viral, yeah.
Yeah. So they have videos of that, but it's pretty crazy. But they'll do small fish, like 3-inch fish when they do the aerial stocking.
Sure.
They only do that because we can't access those places easily.
They're too remote.
Yeah, so anything we could do with the truck, that's what we'll try and do. But if it's crazy out of the way, it becomes take a horse or a backpack with backpacks that we can put on and put fish in. So yeah,
that's awesome. So you would say though the majority of the fish that we stock is by just trucks usually?
Yeah, a majority of the fish we stock is by truck.
Okay.
The cases with the airplane are kind of the extreme cases where it's up way up on the Uintas or way up on the Boulder, and it's just basically impossible. That's the only way we're getting fishing.
Right. How, the horse one is also kind of random to me.
Mm-hmm.
How does that work? Are there just like little like saddlebags?
Yeah.
That you
so they kind of have like a pannier or whatever, you know, you got your big tanks, I guess, off the side that are hanging off. You kind of level it out, 2 tanks on each side of the horse or whatever. And same with the backpack, you got a little tank you'd put in your backpack.
That's so funny.
You got your fish in there and a little bottle of oxygen to get them to wherever.
Do they do pretty good? Like, cause that, I could assume that's kind of sloshy when you're like hiking with fish in your backpack.
Yeah, they do good. I mean, they're pretty resilient, you know, like when we're dumping them out of the truck, people get worried. They're like, oh, it's going to hurt them. I'm like, they'll do good. We never, especially with the trucks, we never lose any.
That's amazing. With the Springville hatchery, you're mostly stocking the ponds. You said you stock a lot of the community ponds along the Wasatch Front.
We're focused on the Wasatch Front community ponds. And that's how it is with a lot of the hatcheries. It's kind of, first off, they have to find a location we can get water for a spring for hatchery. But then it becomes, what's your water temperature? What can you raise? And then we don't want a hatchery clear up north hauling their fish clear down south.
Sure.
We just try and make it
do it
whoever's
proximity.
Closest, try and do what they can do for that region.
Gotcha. And you said here in Springville, you're primarily raising the rainbow trout at the one facility.
Yeah. So we kind of got the two sides of the road here. So our east side of the road is all rainbow trout. So we're raising those, and 99% of those are going to community ponds. Just the local stuff. So we'll go from Santaquin clear up to Brigham City. And then this side, they're starting to do more of the warm water. They just got that rebuilt. So they're starting to do This is where they bring the walleye after they hatch them out, and then they'll go stock them. So they'll bring walleye eggs in, hatch them out, and then take them out within a couple days. And then they're also doing wipers in there. So they're raising out wipers to about 8 or 10 inches.
Gotcha. And how many total hatcheries does DWR manage around the state?
So I had to think about this, but I think it's 13.
Okay, so there's a lot of facilities.
Yeah, there's a lot of facilities. So, yeah, we got ones Logan, Manaway, and then clear down by the border, there's one by Arizona called Walweep. Down by Lake Powell, they have one clear down there, and then spread out all in between.
Yeah, and are most of the hatcheries raising these similar species as Springville?
Not really. There's a lot raising rainbow.
Right.
But to say that one clear down by the border of Arizona, he does a lot of native species for like razorbacks and wound fit, and he does a lot of native stuff. Okay. So he does a lot of pond culture.
Okay.
And it's just all native stuff mostly. He doesn't do a lot of production stuff where people are going out to fish for like sport fish. Them. Yeah.
I see. Yeah, that's interesting. And it was kind of interesting hearing you talk about, I mean, as we've kind of explained, there's a lot that goes into, you know, not only growing these fish, but also keeping them alive, transporting them. Explain kind of some of the challenges with walleye, because that was something that I'd never really heard of.
Yeah, so they've been trying to get a better walleye production. So they've been spawning them at Willard, and then they bring them down here, and I think it's Colorado that they've been working with that they're trying to. So Colorado does the same thing. They spawn them, hatch them out, and they just take them out. But you're putting a lot of fish out there, but the success of them surviving all, you know, not getting eaten and everything at that size, so small, is really low.
Right.
But it's in our experience and everybody else's, it seems like it's been impossible, nearly impossible to raise a fish, a walleye, because they're so predacious. And this is the same with a lot of the fish that are more predator fish, is if you have them in a tank, you've got to be feeding them constantly. You've got to keep it dark, or they'll just sit and eat each other.
Which is so crazy.
It's crazy. You'll see.
They're little cannibals.
We've had times where you go in there and you've got one eating another one. It's like a chain. So like three are trying to eat each other. One's tails in another one's mouth and another one's mouth.
That's so crazy. Yeah. So that, and you said that's why they'll usually stock them a lot smaller.
Yeah. So they're just thinking, their best bet is stock them small, and that way they can, it's almost a shotgun approach. You're blasting a lot out there and hoping that you can get better survival.
Yeah, that's pretty wild to me. And typically though, with the fish that we're raising, because there's the purification stuff, you're monitoring the water quality and things like that. Mm. The survival is pretty good, right? For these fish that we raise and stock.
Yeah. So that was one thing. That's one important reason we need the hatcheries, is because in the wild, so you might get 2 or 3% survival, where, you know, a fish goes and lays an egg and it goes clear from an egg to reproducing.
Sure.
You're only getting like 2 or 3% of the fish ever make it to that point.
Yeah, that's
crazy.
With
the hatcheries, we're getting the eggs, hatching them and raising them up, and we're getting, you know, 95% survival probably most of the time.
Because how old is a fish usually before it can reproduce?
About 3 or 4 years old.
3 or 4 years. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And like you'd explained, we're only raising them about a year, so they're not.
Yeah, they're not ready to spawn at the time we stock them, but I mean, they've gone through that point of avoiding predator fish, you know, when we're stocking them at 10 or 12 inches more than they would have if they were tiny, and just all the other stuff they have to go through.
Right. You know, that totally makes sense. And with a lot of our fish hatcheries, a lot of it sounds like is kind of just to increase that, you know, angler experience, right? To make it so that there's more fish to catch. But you'd kind of talked about with the native fish, we are also helping to increase populations of like some of the endangered fish, like June suckers, right?
You've got your sport fish, which is what we're putting out for people to fish for that are more targeting.
Sure.
And you've got your native fish, like the ones I was talking about down at Walweep and stuff like that, that they're just putting out there to kind of bolster the populations of the natives.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we do a lot of June suckers, and they do a lot of stuff down there, the wound fin and the razorback and all those fish they're doing down there. I have a lot of people come into the hatchery and they don't understand why we have to do this at all. They're just like, why can't you just let it happen naturally? You don't have to do any of this. And it's, there's a lot of different factors, you know, like there may not be places, you know, spawning ground that is suitable for the fish to spawn. There might be rivers that are broken up by dams where fish can't swim up to the places to spawn. And then you've got people, a lot of people just out fishing and taking fish, and you have fish die-offs where, say, a fire comes through and burns a canyon where a river goes down, and then that gets flooded with mud and kills everything.
Right.
It's, nothing's just going to come back there. You know, we have to go in and stock fish and keep it, you know, viable, basically.
That totally makes sense. Yeah, because it's not like plants that can just...
Yeah, they can't move. Yeah, you know, you have to have a connection, a water connection.
Right.
If you're going to get something back in there.
Right. No, that totally makes sense. So what would you say, because you've been with the division for, how long did you say you've worked?
6 years.
6 years. Yeah. What would you say in your experience with the fish hatcheries, what's kind of the hardest part or the biggest challenge of managing a fish hatchery?
I'd say two things. One is just keeping fish alive. Like, it seems like it would just be super simple, but there's a lot that goes into it. There's oxygen, there's temperature issues sometimes, there's, you know, the water not getting purified before it gets to the fish. And I mean, we have all sorts of problems. So just keeping fish alive and healthy is like, it's a 24/7 job. We have guys, we have to have somebody here every day checking to make sure our flows are good, our oxygen's good. Anything that you think could go wrong, you don't even think about half the stuff that could go wrong until it does the first time. And then you remember that and you've got to be on it 24/7.
It's like an immediate thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and I hadn't even thought of that aspect of it until you'd mentioned that. Like, it is like, you're like a rancher, and like, these are, they're animals that need to feed every day. And
they tell us that basically, it's just like, this is a farm and you work when there's work. So sometimes there's seasons where we, you know, build up a bunch of comp time and we're working a lot of days, you know, 7 days a week and 12 or 13 hours a day, because that's when the fish are spawning, or that's when we need to be stocking, or whatever the case may be. And then there's times like in the summer where for trout it slows down. We're not, you know, not as busy, and we can burn some of that time, but it is a lot like farming.
And so what was kind of the second challenge that you have run into?
I think, and then you, and this is more to the biologist point than the hatcheries, but you're always trying to balance native, sport fish, people's interests. Like, you could go to a pond, one person wants one fish and one person wants another fish. You know, one person wants more fish, one person wants bigger fish.
I see.
So you're always, I think, a lot of that. And then
trying
managing,
to balance.
Yeah, and then managing your size too, your size of your fish and your space. Because you, if you, if you're not on top of managing how big your fish are getting and how many you have, you know, what your hatchery capacity is, you can run out of space real fast.
That totally makes sense. And is that part of why it's harder to get them a lot bigger before we stock them? Just the size, and I guess it's expensive to feed them that long.
It's more, yeah, I mean, when you're feeding them, it's more expensive. But I think the biggest issue is why we're shooting for like a 9-inch fish or a 10-inch fish instead of a 18-inch fish is just space.
I see.
So we last, in the last couple of years, we've kind of been transitioning from a 9-inch fish to a 10-inch fish. And we used to raise, you know, upper 400,000s numbers wise. So we'd raise 400,000 fish in a year. And that was when it was a 9-inch fish. When we went from a 9-inch fish to a 10-inch fish, we actually put out 100,000 less fish, right in that ballpark, you know?
Right.
But that's just because when you're adding that extra inch and that girth size to a fish, it's just taking up that much more space, and it's just can only raise what you have space and water for.
Yeah, that makes sense. And I guess it probably increases the survival rate the bigger they get, right?
Yeah.
For when you stock them.
Yeah. So I think they always are trying to find a sweet spot too, where it's like, what fish in here could eat these fish, or what birds are targeting our fish? And for us, we get a lot of bird predation in these community ponds. So they're always trying to say, oh, you know, how big could we get and still get a lot of quality fish out there that are not going to get eaten by the birds as much too. So that they're always trying to find a sweet spot where it's like, we're raising them so they're not getting eaten, but we're also putting out numbers too.
Sure. That people want to catch.
Yeah.
That size. Right. What would you say is one of your favorite memories in the time that you've been working here, or kind of a favorite experience that you've had?
I'd say stocking on the Uintas is one of my favorite things to do. We don't do that much. Like, it was mostly Camas's fish. Sometimes they need, you know, we go help other fish hatcheries.
The fish hatchery up there.
Yeah, so they were shorthanded, so we were just going up and actually loading their fish and hauling them out for them. And we'd get to go haul fish on the Uintas. That was a lot of fun. It's amazing up there, you know. It's crazy that you're going and putting in, you know, you're just driving down all these crazy dirt roads and getting the stockfish in all these backwoods places.
And with some of those, you are driving a truck. You can drive a truck up there.
Yeah, so there's a lot of, I mean, I don't know how many lakes there is up there, but there's a ton of lakes. So there's a bunch you can access with the trucks, but then a few that you have to get with the planes.
Have you ever done any plane stocking
yourself? No, I haven't done any plane stocking. And I don't know if they let us ride along. I'm sure Ted up at Camas has. But as far as they have, you know, somebody that flies it and does all their own things. So our part is just mostly loading. We show up to the airstrip with the fish and load them in way early in the morning, and then they haul them out and take them wherever they need to go.
Yeah, I've seen those videos though, and they are pretty wild.
Yeah, it's crazy.
That's a cool process. Awesome. Well, yeah, thanks for, you know, taking a minute to kind of explain some of this. Like I said, before I started that little tour with you, I had no idea.
I hope that what we said here makes sense, you know, for people who haven't seen it, you know.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to picture in your mind some of it, but yeah, it was good.
Yeah, no, and it's a super cool process. So thank you. And to all of our listeners, if you haven't yet, we'd love if you could subscribe to the Wild Podcast. You can find that anywhere that you listen to podcasts. And we release a new episode on the third Tuesday of each month. And so we hope that you'll tune in next month for some more wildlife stories.